to the Virtual Mission Concert 2021. Woo! Many times in the past, we've had a fantastic concert in the summer in the back garden. And this year in 2021, for the first time, we are having a concert in the winter and we're having a socially distanced concert. I hope that all of you are 2 meters apart from each other. My name is Charlie Fillingham and I will be your host for this evening. It is great to see you all. Welcome. I'm now going to introduce our very first act. Without further ado, it is Hannah Webster singing Jolene.
Breath of spring, your voice is soft like summer rain, and I cannot compete with you, Jolene. He talks about you in his sleep. There's nothing I can do to keep from crying when he calls the name Jolene. And I could easily understand how you could easily take my man, but you don't know what he means. Jolene, 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 I'm begging of you, please don't take my man. Jolene, 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 please don't take him just because you can. You could have your choice of man, but I can never love again. The only one for me, Jolene. I had to have this talk with you. My happiness depends on you. Whatever you decide to do, Jolene. Jolene, 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 Jolene. I'm begging of you, please don't take my man. Jolene.
Amazing, amazing. Kicking us off, one of our own sixth formers from Archbishop Tennyson School. So great to hear you, Hannah. What an amazing first performance. So welcome, everybody, from me, from Fillingham Towers here in South Croydon. Some of you, I know you're all socially distanced from each other, but some of you, of course, are even further away than that. Some of you perhaps are 2 metres from each other. Some of us are 2 miles apart, and some of you are even 200 miles apart. I'm inviting you now to use the chat function on Zoom and let me know where you are, so that after our next song, I'd be able to shout out some hellos to people in the far-flung corners of the United Kingdom and perhaps even further afield than that. You are all welcome here this evening, and the purpose of this evening is to have a bit of fun, to enjoy ourselves, to appreciate the most fantastic music. And later on, I'll tell you about a couple of the very special features that we're having. But before we go on to that, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our next act. Our next act is a mother and daughter performance. It's Kaz and Lucy Heath, and they are playing a flute piece. Take it away.
Thank you.
Well done to both of you. That was fantastic. That was the Allegro by Devienne, a French composer from the 1700s. Let's see now, where are we? I've been following you on my second telephone here. We've got people as far away as Dulwich, Hartford Heath, South Croydon, Ridge Langley. That does sound exotic. I wonder where that is. It seems to be about 400 metres away. We've got people from Cheshire, though, and from Durham, and from Surrey, and even as far away as Ballard's Farm. You are welcome here this evening. We're going to have a great show. We've got all kinds of different performers, and the performers, by and large, are drawn from Emmanuel Church. It is the most fantastic community here in South Croydon. And at a time when we're often so far apart from each other, isn't it great to be together? There are over 100 people zoomed in on this call, which I guess means that there are 200 or even 300 people watching altogether. So let us enjoy our evening. And the next performance that we have for you is a radio play. So sit back, close your eyes if you wish, and listen. And any of you who've ever been involved in education will know that although this is a radio play written in the 1960s, working with small children has not changed so much since then. I'm very pleased to introduce Lizzy Fillingham.
Children, pay attention, please. Everybody turn around this way, please. We've got a lovely surprise this morning. We've got a visitor. Isn't that nice? Is it, Sydney? And what do we say to our visitor? We say, good morning, visitor. No, Peggy, our visitor hasn't got a funny hat on. That's her hair. I'm so sorry, Mrs. Hingle. I'm afraid we're slightly outspoken sometimes. Well, you find us having a free activity period this morning. And in our free activity period, each little individual chooses his or her own form of occupation. Get out from under the table there, Sydney. Yes, some of us paint and some of us do plasticine work or go to a sand table over there. We feel that each individual has got to get to the bottom of himself, learn what he wants of life. Who is making that buzzing noise? Well, stop it please, Neville. Hazel, dear, come away from the door and find something to do. I do love to see them so happily occupied, each little one expressing his own personality. George, don't do that. And this is my friend Caroline, and Caroline's painting such a lovely red picture, aren't you, Caroline? I wonder what it is. Perhaps it's a lovely red orange, is it? Or a sunset? Oh, it's a picture of Mummy. For a moment I thought it was an orange, but now that you tell me, I can see it's Mummy. Aren't you going to give her any nose? No? No nose. I think it's very interesting the way they see things, don't you? Sydney, stop blowing at Edgar and get something to do. Yes, I know I said you could choose what to do, but you cannot choose to blow at Edgar. Well, because I don't think it's a very good idea. Well, because I'm not going to discuss it with you, Sydney. Go over there and join Susan at her sand table. Yes, there is room, Sue. There's heaps of room. Just move up. Susan, we never bite our friends. Now say you're sorry to Sydney. No, you needn't kiss him. No, you needn't hug him. Susan, put him down. Sydney, I'm afraid some of our ego is a little on the big side today, Mrs. Hingle. Now, Hazel, I don't want to speak to you again. Please come away from that door. Well, why can't you? Well, you shouldn't put your finger in a keyhole and then it wouldn't get stuck in there, would it? Children, I don't think there is any need for everyone to come and look just because poor Hazel's got her finger stuck in a keyhole. Now then, Hazel, why did you put your finger in the keyhole? To see if it would go in. Well, let's see if we can get it out, shall we? Oh, it is stuck in there, isn't it? No, Sydney, I don't think Hazel's finger will be stuck in the keyhole forever and ever. And I don't suppose for a moment we shall have to get the fire brigade to come along and take the door down so that we can just get poor Hazel's finger out. Oh, you do exaggerate, Sydney. Well, if we don't get her finger out by dinner time, she'll have to have her dinner here. And her tea. And her supper and stay the night. But we're going to get a towel, aren't we, Hazel? Who is making that buzzing noise? Neville, I don't want to speak to you again. Yes, I know you're a busy bee, but I don't want to hear you buzzing. No, not even very quietly. I can still hear you, Neville. Neville. I should think so. He is such a musical child, and you know, one doesn't like to discourage them. Sydney, please take that paintbrush out of your ear and give it back to Lavinia. Yes, you do want it, Lavinia. Yes, you do. You love painting. Yes, you do. Yes, dear, you love painting. George! Don't do that. Now then, Hazel. Oh dear, it is stuck, isn't it? Mrs. Hinkle, this child's fingers are really stuck in the keyhole. Well, I think the fire brigade are best in an emergency, don't you? Yes, I have. I have a telephone in my office. Would you? Oh, I am grateful. Thank you very much. Well, I'll just tell the children. Children, I want everyone to be very grown up and very sensible. We're going to see if we can get one of those nice firemen to get Hazel's finger out of the key. Oh, you got it out! Oh, well done, Hazel. Mrs. Hingle, she got it out! Oh, isn't that lovely? Sydney, you're not to go near that door. Sydney, you're not to put your finger... I spoke too soon, Mrs. Hingle. Oh, Sydney.
Oh, Sydney. Thank you, Lizzy. A great performance. That's Lizzy, a 12-year-old, and we've had a couple of other younger children. Lucie, of course, Heath, even younger. We've got a next guest for you, I'll introduce in a moment. But let me first say a welcome to people dialing in from Tunbridge Wells. I saw your message in the chat. And everybody else, if you'd like to use the chat to send messages, perhaps to be read out for... to congratulate our performers, please remember it's a family show. Just go ahead and type things in as our performers are playing for us. Now, picture the scene. You're in The Hobbit. You're in The Lord of the Rings. You are Frodo and you are far from home. It's a scary time. This is the moment that Carol and Alice have chosen to present to us. And I don't know if you've ever seen the musical version of The Lord of the Rings, but they have, and they've chosen a song for us, which is called Now and For Always. And it is a moment describing fear and friendship. Take it away, ladies.
Sing me a story of heroes of the shore, muddling through, brave and true, stubborn as bindweed and tough as oak wood, never too showy or grand. Year after year, they persevere, now and for always.
Often to plant it and store folk who plowed, bread to endure, slow but sure. Valor, blood in your veins makes you proud, steady and steady they stand. True to
gallant retreats, just followed his feet. Now and for always, sit by the firelight's glow, tell us an old tale we know, tell of adventure strange and rare, never to change, ever to share, stories we tell.
Brilliant. What a lovely song. Thank you so much. Now, I'd like to give a big shout out to Jeremy Stevens. Hello, very nice to see you. Hope you're being well behaved. Lovely to see so many people on the chat bar praising that magnificent choice. Listen, now, just while they were singing, I was scrolling through, looking at the all of the audience out there in Zoom land. It did appear to me that one or two people have not caught the dress code that was on the memo. If you scroll down to the bottom of the invitation, I'm sure it said dress to impress, black tie. So if anybody wants to use the interval a little bit later, go and get changed and dress up a little bit. We're taking this seriously here at Emmanuel Church at our virtual mission concert. Now, very nice. Let's see. Our next piece of music is a song from 1975. It became Queen's best known and biggest hit. And it's a song, as you and I know, with many different parts. But you'll be seeing this song this evening, perhaps in a format that you are not used to, being performed in many different parts by one person. I am delighted to welcome Joey Roseweir to the stage to perform Bohemian Rhapsody.
Thank you. Charlie, you're still on mute.
On mute. Ah, yes. You caught me out there, Joey. I was expecting it to go on for a moment longer. That's absolutely fantastic. I don't know, Joey, if you're looking at the chat bar as we go through that, but there is a lot of amazing praise for you, and it is richly deserved. And your performance, Joey, gives me a chance to thank some other members of your family. Al is here. Emma is here. Al's your dad. Emma's your sister. And they are stitching this whole thing together and doing all the great tech work behind the scenes. May I also thank Ian Christie, who's prepared some of the tech work in advance of tonight. What a great show we are having. Our next guest is Jeremy Davis. Jeremy Davis was at university in 1972, and so perhaps had even finished university before that last song came out. He met Yuritsa, they got married, they had children, they now have 9 grandchildren. That hasn't stopped him from losing his sense of humour. He's a great preacher, we know him well from our church, and he's chosen something to perform for us tonight called Temperance. Take it away, Jeremy.
Good evening. One of the things I found myself doing last year during lockdown was reading a family history written by a distant cousin called Keith. Actually, Keith's not really a very distant cousin, he only lives in Sutton, but he is from a different branch of the family. And what he wrote has now been printed and bound, and this is it. The history of the Percy family, going right back into the 18th century. One of the things that I found most striking as I read this was the strong association that my ancestors had with the temperance movement. They were very opposed to the drinking of alcohol. Now, I always knew that my father had been the treasurer of the Temperance Society in Dudley, which was the town where we lived. And I discovered from this that my great uncle had been the president of Dudley Temperance Society for many years, but that it went back further. My grandfather, my great-grandfather, and my great-great-grandfather were all pillars of the Temperance Society and all pillars of the Methodist Church. This panel behind me is a gold leaf panel from the pulpit of the Victorian building in which they all worshipped for generations, the building in which I used to go to church as a child. I'm happy to say, I think, that that association with the Temperance Society came to an abrupt halt with my generation, at least so far as this branch of the family tree is concerned. But as I was reading about it, my mind went back to a little ditty that I heard years and years ago. I can't remember where I heard it or who sang it, and I have no idea who wrote it. But the words obviously imprinted themselves on my brain because I found myself singing it to myself as I was reading about this association with the Temperance Society, a little warning against drink. And I thought I would sing it to you tonight. And I'm wondering whether my great-grandfather and great-great-grandfather would be pleased that I was singing it to you, or whether they might think I was just a complete hypocrite. Well, here it is. There was a poor young boy who left his country home and came to the city to seek employment. He promised his dear mother that he'd lead the simple life and always shun the fatal curse of drink. Well, he came to the city and found employment in a quarry, and while there he made the acquaintance of some college men. He little knew that they were demons, for they wore the best of clothes, but clothes do not always make the gentleman. Well, one night he went out with his newfound friends to dine, and while there they tried to persuade him to take a drink. They tempted him and tempted him, but he refused and he refused, till finally he took a sip of beer. When he saw what he had done, he dashed the liquor to the ground and staggered out the door with delirium tremens. And while in the grip of liquor, he met a Salvation Army lassie. And cruelly, he broke her tambourine. All she said was, "Heaven bless you," and laid a mark upon his brow with a kick that she'd learned before she was saved. So, kind friends, take my advice and shun the fatal curse of drink, and don't go round breaking people's tambourines. Cheers.
Wow, thank you, Jeremy. I've got a few snacks here, Jeremy. Whoops, there goes one. Like you, I'm also enjoying a drink with our wonderful concert. Now, Jeremy, I don't know if you are like Simon Smith and have been looking very carefully at the VMC, the Virtual Mission Concert website, because on the Virtual Mission Concert website, there are some recipes that some of you might be following for buffets by design. Buffets by Design are not sponsoring our event this evening, but they often give to the church and support the church, and they give us some super recipes. So if there is an act and you have the time to listen and also head over to the VMC website, you can do that and find out what you could be eating. Now, let me put those things down and welcome our next guest. Deborah Wells is a teacher at Coombwood School, and you can't clap because you're on mute, but I'm going to clap for you, for the teachers. Gracious, what crazy days we live in, everybody. It is a funny time to be a teacher and not to be in the classroom. But Deb Wells is one. I know she's doing a fantastic job, and she's a music teacher, which makes her a perfect guest this evening. Deborah, we're so pleased that you've chosen a song with another 1970s theme from the 1972 movie Cabaret. And you've chosen to perform for us, maybe this time.
Maybe this time I'll be lucky. Maybe this time he'll stay. Maybe this time, for the first time, love won't hurry away. He will hold me fast. I'll be home at last. Not a loser anymore, like the last time and the time before. Everybody loves a winner, so nobody loved me. Lady Peaceful, Lady Happy, that's what I long to be. All the odds are in my favor, something's bound to begin. It's gotta happen, happen sometime. Maybe this time I'll win. Everybody loves a winner, so nobody loved me. Lady Peaceful, Lady Happy, that's what I long to be. In my favor, something's bound to be.
Great, as well done, Deb. That was absolutely fantastic. Now, listen, everybody, if you're feeling a bit technologically minded, like me, you could be on your phone at the same time and you could be typing in vmc.org.uk and you can pull up the website for the concert. And if you see each of the people has a picture here. So there is Debs, and it tells us what she's singing. There's more information too on vmc.org.uk, and I'll take you back there a little bit later on. But if you've got a moment, tap it into your computer, tap it into your telephone, and start pulling up the information. And this is working as your virtual program for the evening, because we haven't got a paper program to give you. See how technologically minded we are here. It is very nice to be seeing you. I've just seen one or two people misbehaving on the screen there. Cut that out. It's not that kind of show. I'd like to introduce our next act. Like me, perhaps you've enjoyed reading the Just So stories to your children at bedtime. Written by Rudyard Kipling, such fantastic stories which have stood the test of time. The manuscripts to these stories are actually kept in the British Library. And this one, which Helen Draper is going to perform to us, is called How the Rhinoceros Got His Skin.
Hello. I'm going to read you a story about a rhinoceros, and it's by Rudyard Kipling, who was a man who lived in Bombay. He was born in 1865. He lived part of his life in Bombay, where he wrote stories, and he was a journalist. He wrote stories about the jungle and India and animals. The famous one is The Jungle Book. But the rhinoceros story comes from the Just So stories, which were written for children, probably. They got very strange language, but I quite like the language, and I hope you will too. How the Rhinoceros Got His Skin. Once upon a time, on an uninhabited island on the shores of the Red Sea, there lived a Parsee, from whose hat the rays of the sun were reflected in more than oriental splendour. And the Parsee lived by the Red Sea with nothing but his hat and his knife and his cooking pot. And one day he took flour and water and currants and plums and sugar and things and made himself one cake, which was 2 feet across and 3 feet thick. It was indeed a most superior comestible. And he put it on the stove and he baked it. And he baked it till it was all done brown and smelt most sentimental. And just as he was going to eat it, there came down to the beach from the uninhabited interior one rhinoceros with a horn on his nose, two piggy eyes, and few manners. In those days, the rhinoceros's skin fitted him quite tight. There were no wrinkles in it anywhere. He looked exactly like a Noah's Ark rhinoceros, but of course much bigger. All the same, he had no manners then, and he has no manners now. And he never will have any manners. He said, "How?" And the Parsee left that cake and climbed to the top of a palm tree with nothing on but his hat, from which the rays of the sun were reflected in more than oriental splendour. And the rhinoceros upset the oil stove with his nose, and the cake rolled on the sand. And he spiked that cake on the horn of his nose and he ate it. And he went away waving his tail. And the Parsee came down from his palm tree and put the stove on its legs and recited the following words, which, as you have not heard them, I will now proceed to relate. Them that cakes cakes that the Parsee man bakes, makes dreadful mistakes. And there was a great deal more in this than you could possibly think. Because 5 weeks later, There was a heat wave in the Red Sea, and everybody took off all the clothes they had. The Parsi took off his hat, but the rhinoceros took off his skin and carried it over his shoulder as he came down to the beach to bathe. In those days, it buttoned underneath with three buttons and looked like a waterproof. He said nothing whatever about the Parsi's cake because he had eaten it all. He waddled straight into the water and blew bubbles through his nose, leaving his skin on the beach. Presently, the Parsi came by and found the skin, and he smiled one smile that ran all the way round his face two times. Then he danced three times round the skin and rubbed his hands. Then he went to his camp and filled his hat with cake crumbs, for the Parsi never made anything but cake and never swept out his camp. He took that skin and he rubbed that skin just as full of old, dry, stale, tickly cake crumbs and some burned currants as ever it could possibly hold. Then he climbed to the top of his palm tree and waited for the rhinoceros to come out of the water and put it on. Here is a picture of the Parsi in his palm tree. And the rhinoceros did. He buttoned it up with three buttons and it tickled just like cake crumbs in bed. Then he wanted to scratch, but that made it worse. Then he lay down on the sand and rolled and rolled and rolled. And every time he rolled, the cake crumbs tickled him worse and worse and worse. Then he ran to the palm tree and rubbed and rubbed and rubbed himself against it. He rubbed so much and so hard that he rubbed his skin into a great fold over his shoulders and another fold underneath where the buttons used to be. But he rubbed the buttons off. And he rubbed some more folds over his legs. And it spoiled his temper. But it didn't make the least difference to the cake crumbs. They were inside his skin and they tickled. So he went home very angry indeed and horribly scratchy. And from that day to this, every rhinoceros has great folds in his skin and a very bad temper, all on account of the cake crumbs inside. But the Parsi came down from his palm tree wearing his hat, from which the rays of the sun were reflected in more than oriental splendour, and picked up his cooking stove and went away in the direction of Orotavo and the marshes of Sonaput. The end.
Thank you so much, Helen. You read that beautifully. And he rubbed his buttons off. Poor old rhinoceros, now we know how he got his skin. Listen, Helen, you're going to love this next one. The next act I'm so pleased to introduce features Simon Smith. And people watching at home, you may not know that Simon Smith is our host. He's hosting this concert. The concert has been his brainwave, his brainchild for a decade or more. He's hosted us in his back garden in Melville Avenue on several occasions, many occasions, but can't host us this evening. He's also a man who brings things together, brings people together, and he's brought together the most amazing band. All kinds of people have belonged to his band over the years, and it's called Kingsfolk. This evening they're going to play Mari's Wedding for us, an Irish Gaelic song. And there's one thing I want you to look out for. Look out, please, for the violin that Jocelyn is playing, because that violin was made by her mother, Penny, in 2020. It is a brand new violin. It is literally a homemade violin. And I think you'll agree with me that it sounds fantastic. Kingsfolk. Thank you. Congratulations, Mari. I wonder who you married. Mari's wedding by Kingsfolk, everybody. Now, I don't know about you, but I've been following the chat as we've been going along on my other telephone, and there have been some great jokes. If you haven't seen it, you should hear this one. Thank you, David. What is the best thing about Switzerland? I don't know, but the flag is a big plus. That's a great one. Now listen, if there are any children watching, or indeed any adults who want to send in their joke during the next song, I will pick out one or two great ones to read out to you after this next song. Our next act is taking us from Ireland, of course our closest neighbours, to France, our next closest neighbours, just the other side of the English Channel. How wonderful that Sarah has chosen a song to sing to us in French, bringing a new spirit of internationalism to the concert this evening. She's going to sing Charles Trenet's song, La Mer. She's singing it in French, and you'll find out why if you don't already know the story when I invite her back on the screen a little bit afterwards. Take it away, Sarah.
La mer, on va danser le long des golfes à des reflets d'argent. La mer, des reflets changeants sous la brise. La mer, paupières d'été. C'est longtemps avec les anges si pur. La mer, bergère d'azur infinie. Voyez près des étangs ces grands roses. Des reflets clairs
d'une chanson d'amour. La mer a bercé mon cœur pour la vie.
She paints, she sings, you know, what else? And I was really loving that French mood washing over me and reading your jokes at the same time. Well done, Sarah. That was fantastic. There's a French joke for you. So awful. I will share it anyway. Why does a Frenchman only have one egg at breakfast? Because it's enough. I know. That's really terrible. I've got one for you. What is round and nasty? A vicious circle. Oh, yes. I bet I got that one. That's one of mine, actually. There's no charge. That's free this evening. A guy split his Scrabble on the street earlier, and I asked him, what was the word on the street? He replied, I don't know, but it's got an E in it. Thank you, Sinclairs. But there is one that I particularly like. I'm not sure it's come from one of the children, but it seems to come from Ben and Tors Jones. And if you haven't seen it, it made me laugh out loud. What is the difference between a hippo and a Zippo? One is very heavy and the other's a little light. The other's a little lighter. Oh, that's very good. That's very good indeed. Now let's see, what do I want to show you next? I'm hoping that you're on the virtual mission. Look at that, David Lawton. Hoping you're on the virtual mission concert website at the same time. I'm going to tell you why I want you to be on that in a moment. But first, it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Jack and Sarah. We've heard Sarah sing. Now it's time to hear her speak. And tonight's concert is really in aid of Jack and Sarah and another charity that we're going to hear about a little bit later on. And we will be asking for donations to support these two magnificent causes tonight. And after Jack and Sarah have spoken, I'll show you how you can start donating. But let me hand over to them for the news about their journey to France.
Good evening. Thank you very much for having us. We're really glad to be here. My name's Jack. This is Sarah. We have a son, Ben, who's one. And we'd like to let you know a bit more about what we're going to do in France and why.
So why France? It's not because we like pastries particularly, or although Jack does like pastries, and it's not for the sunshine. France has been on my heart particularly for several years as a place that has less access to hearing the gospel than we do here in the UK. And since about 1905, there's been a very strict secularism, a separation between church and state. That means that religion is seen as something very private, and if you work in a public sector job, you're not allowed to share your faith during your work hours, you're not allowed to wear an ostentatious religious symbol, as such, there's no religious education in schools, even in Catholic schools. And as such, there's been a couple of generations growing up with very limited understanding of who Jesus is. And that makes me really have a heart for the French nation. One statistic that really shocked me was that although about 50% of the country still identify in some way as Catholic, and 10% as Muslim, 1% as Evangelical Christian, the weekly attendance at worship is the same for all three groups. So that means that although 50% of people call themselves Catholic, the same number of them are going to Mass weekly as the 1% of evangelicals. And that just shows me how much this country needs to hear about Jesus.
We are going to go to Tours, a city in the centre of France, and we're going to work alongside the evangelical church there. We're going to be pastoral assistants, and we're open to seeing the ways in which we can be useful once we arrive. We're open to being involved in all sorts of ways. I'm particularly keen to be involved in evangelism and preaching, and we're both keen to be encouraging Christians in France. During that first year, I'll be studying French. We're prepared to be in France for the long term, for 10 or so years. And we know that the language is really important. Sarah speaks French already, but I'll be studying French roughly full-time that first year to invest for being useful in the long term.
And that's one of the things that your support will go towards, Jack's French language learning course. I thought I'd share with you some of our hopes and dreams for France, because although the details of what we'll be doing in our weekly timetable are quite flexible. We do have some hopes and dreams that we'd love to see happen in France. And Jack in particular has really got a heart for evangelism. I'm really excited by a recent church planting movement that's been taking place in France. There are a number of small church plants in the nearby towns around Tours where we're going. And I would be, really excited to join in with a new church plant or to support those existing church plants. Thank you very much for having us, and hope you're well, and God bless.
Thanks very much.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, both of you. Thanks for speaking to us this evening, and bon voyage. We wish you a safe journey. Listen, if you're on the, people who are watching now, if you're on your phone or on your computer at the vmc.org.uk, you can see David Lawton with a baton in his hand. Scroll down, go through the pictures, go past the programme, go through the suggested snacks. You haven't got to snacks yet. Here's more information about the two charities we're supporting. Scroll down, go through the snacks. They look lovely, buffet by design. And you get to the bottom. And at the bottom there is a button called donate. If you would like to donate this evening, £5, £10, £50, £100, we will be splitting the money 50-50 between Jack and Sarah we've just heard about, and the second charity, the Daniel Spargo-Mabbs Foundation, that we will hear about a little bit later on. There's a short break now. These are two worthy causes. I encourage you to donate if you possibly can. There'll be a short break of 5 minutes. There'll be a countdown clock. And when the 5 minutes finishes, we will go straight into Kingsfolk. So I will see you again back here just after Kingsfolk's next song. Enjoy your break. Bye-bye. Amazing, the house band. Thank you, Kingsfolk. Thank you for singing us a second number and bringing us back from our very short interval. There's another couple of jokes that have come in that I'd like to share with you. This is a very modern joke. Forgive me if you're a little bit less modern than me. What do you call two monkeys that share an Amazon account? Primates, Amazon Primes. Very good. Let's see, there's one more. What do you call a droid that takes the long way around? R2-D tour. Keep those coming in. Thank you. Keep those coming into the chat. Also, keep pouring in some praise for these wonderful performances that we're having. And I think the people who performed for us are now watching live with us. How nice for them to be able to see that we're really enjoying their show and that we're really enjoying what they've put together. Now, audience, there is a treat for you next. David Lawton features on the vmc.org.uk homepage, and there's a great big picture of him holding a baton. He always keeps his performances as a great surprise to us, and so we don't really know what he's going to perform this evening at all. But it's called Another Side Of. Let's see what it is, David. What have you got for us?
Well, hello. If you were planning on popping out to make a cup of tea at some point this evening, this could be your moment.
Thank you, David. You have completely mellowed us out with your mellow music. Absolutely fantastic. And some very deserved praises come in the chat bar for you. Brilliant and rocking. And indeed it was. Many thanks, David. I'm pressing straight into another piece of music, everybody. And the next piece is going to be performed by us by Lucie Stranack and Hannah Keresey. It's a song. It's called You and I. It's originally by Ingrid Michaelson. Take it away, ladies.
Let's get rich and build a house on a mountain, making every towns in the south of France. Let's get rich and give everybody nice sweaters and teach them how to dance. Let's get rich and build a house on a mountain, making everybody look like ants. From way up there, it's you and I, you and I.
Well done, ladies. That was fantastic. Fantastic. So beautiful. And to be playing, both of you playing the ukulele, singing along, you are a very impressive couple of performers. Listen, I know Hannah very well from the Rock TV and from the Rock and now from the Rock TV Live. I've never seen her sing so beautifully as that. But I've seen her dance, I've seen her perform, I've seen her present. She's a very talented young person. I'm very pleased this evening to introduce our next act, who is known to many of us as the face of the Rock TV Live. He is the children's worker at church. He is absolutely fantastic, a first-class performer. Sheridan Lloyd is singing for us, You Are Welcome, from the film Moana.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? Toot-toot. Great. Okay. First of all, to say massive thank you to Charlie for leading us through. Thank you, Mr. Phil. Maybe everyone could put up their glasses as a cheers. Whatever you're drinking, this is tea, I promise. Cheers. Hang on. Can I see everyone cheersing? Yeah, we can cheers. Woo. Right. On with the show. Lovely to hear about Jack and all of the work. That's great. It's great going on. Right. So you're welcome from Moana. Okay. Let me show you a picture. Some people don't know what it looks like. That's him there, look. Maui. So that's who I'm trying to impersonate tonight. So if you know this song very well, I'm sorry. And if you don't know this song, I'm still sorry. Here we go. Okay, I see what's happening here. You're face to face with greatness and it's strange. You don't even know how you feel. It's adorable. Well, it's nice to see that humans never change. Open your eyes, let's begin. Yes, it's really me, it's Maui, breathe it in. I know it's a lot, the hair, the bod. When you're staring at a demigod, what can I say except you're welcome? For the ties, the sun of the sky. Hey, it's okay, you're welcome. I'm just an ordinary demi-guy. Hey, what has two thumbs and pulled up the sky? When you were waddling yay high, this guy. When the nights got cold, who stole you fire from down below? You're looking at him, yo. Oh, also I lassoed the sun. You're welcome to pledge your days and bring you fun. Also I harnessed the breeze. You're welcome to fill your sails and shake your trees. So what can I say except you're welcome? For the islands I pull from the sea. There's no need to pray, it's okay, you're welcome. Ha! I guess that's just my way of being me. You're welcome. Welcome to think of it. Kid, honestly, I could go on and on. I can explain every natural phenomenon. The tide, the grass, the ground. Oh, that was Maui just messing around. I killed Neil. I buried his guts. Sprouted a tree, now you got coconuts. What's the lesson? What is the takeaway? Don't mess with Maui when he's on a vagaway. I'm the tapestry here in my skin. It's the map of the history I win. Look where I've been. I make everything happen. Look at that mean mini Maui just dippity-dappin'. Ha, 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 hey! For the wonderful world you know. Hey, it's okay, you're welcome. Well, come to think of it, I gotta go. Hey, it's your day to say you're welcome. Cause I'm gonna need that boat. I'm sailing away, you're welcome. Cause man, we can't do anything but float. You're welcome, you're welcome. And thank you! Thanks very much. Thank you.
Brilliant, Sheridan. You are such an amazing performer. We are so lucky to have you leading up the children's work at our church. You do such an amazing job. Thank you. Now, listen, everybody. I said to you there are two charities that we're thinking about this evening. And we heard from Jack and Sarah, who are on an adventure, very exciting plans, taking the gospel to France. But in a moment, I'm going to introduce to you two different people, Tim and Fiona Spargo-Mabbs, also a married couple. Tim and Fiona lost their son 7 years ago, this month. He died from taking drugs. And that's something they've been living with since. They've chosen to perform something for us, Psalm 23. And then they're going to speak to us. Well, in fact, then we're going to see a presentation, a trailer for a piece of theatre that is very much inspired by the story of their son, of Daniel. Inspired by that, and then you'll come back to me again, and I hope I'll be able to talk to you again about their fantastic charity that they've set up in honour of their son. We look forward to hearing the psalm. Thank you, Tim and Fiona.
Psalm 23.
The Lord is my shepherd.
I lack nothing.
He makes me lie down in green pastures.
He leads me beside quiet waters.
He refreshes my soul.
He guides me along the right path for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley,
I will fear no evil.
For you are with me.
Your rod and your staff,
they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil.
My cup overflows.
Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
I first saw him in maths looking really attractive. He had banter with everyone and he'd mimic you, but it wasn't like mean or anything.
We grew as people together. We saw bands out till one in the morning, just me and him.
He was a boy with everything to live for.
He walked barefoot from Croydon to central London.
I'll only go if you go.
You'll have fun with Jack and the others.
Dad!
Dad!
Tim and Fiona, thanks for joining us this evening. What have you got to say?
Hi, it's a pleasure, Charlie. Thank you so much. I'm Tim. This must be Fiona. Well, as Charlie's already said, the Daniel Spargo-Mabbs Foundation is a drugs education charity that we set up when our 16-year-old son, Dan, died taking ecstasy. And that was 7 years ago last Wednesday. Many of you may have known Dan because he very much grew up at Emmanuel. We moved to the church when Dan was seven, nearly eight, and Jacob was 10. He moved through what's now the Rock, the Friday night youth work, and he went to Carroty Wood and Soul Survivor. He'd even signed up for the first youth alpha course at the church, but he died 2 days before it started.
Dan was the very last person anyone would expect to die from drugs, but he did. And when that happened, we realised that this is something that could happen to anyone's child, and we needed to do absolutely everything we could to stop that. We realised that young people are making decisions about drugs on an increasing basis because they're exposed to them now in a way that they haven't been for a long, 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 long time. And we realised that drugs education was incredibly patchy, which is why we started a drugs education charity. And we've been doing all sorts of things. It's grown and grown and grown and grown over the last 7 years. And you can have a read in the information on the website here or on our website to find out a little bit more about what we're doing. The film of the play, one of the many things that we've done was to commission a play that tells Dan's story by this amazing playwright, Mark Wheeler. And that was published 4 years ago. It's going to become a GCSE drama set text from next year, which is incredible. It's been studied and performed already all around the world. And we've commissioned theatre and education tours of London schools for the last 4 years and one in Scotland as well. When COVID hit, we realised we weren't going to be able to do live performances. We worked with the theatre company who were preparing a new production for Scotland to have that professionally filmed. So we're now planning two virtual theatre and education tours, one in London, one in Edinburgh and Glasgow in the summer, when hopefully we'll be able to do that sort of thing. We're doing so many things and just trying to come at this every which way we can. One of the things to tell you about is that I've written a book for parents, just a little tiny plug, but it just came out. It's called I Wish I'd Known, because it's everything that I wish I'd known 7 years ago. Lovely foreword by Rob Parton, and it went online for pre-orders last week, but it's going to be published on Dan's birthday in May. Do have a look at the website. Do follow us on Facebook as well if you don't already. I know many of you here will do already, and see a little bit more about what we're doing and why.
Emmanuel's been part of all this from the very start. As a family, we don't know how we'd have survived in those dreadful early first days, weeks and months without you guys looking after us. Mm-hmm. The charity very much grew out of the community of support of our church family. It's meant so much to us to be one of the church's mission partners for the last few years. So we want to say a huge thank you tonight to you at Emmanuel, to everyone here this evening for supporting this really important work, saving young people's lives. We don't think there's anything that can beat that. We were going to leave you with a trailer of the play, but I think you've seen that. We're just going to leave you with a cry from the heart. Thank you. We're very grateful to God for the last few years, for the many doors that he's opened for us. And it's been at concerts like this, sometimes people have come up to us afterwards and said, how can I get involved? If that's you, message us. We'd love to talk to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Fiona. We are so pleased to have you with us this evening. Thank you for the beautiful reading you did and for speaking from the heart. Members of the audience, I'm back on my phone again and I'm scrolling all the way down to the bottom of the page. And all the way down to the bottom of the page, you can find out more about the Daniel Spargo-Mabbs Foundation, and you can donate to support the Daniel Spargo-Mabbs Foundation. Please do if you possibly can. Drugs education for children is important, and we can help that this evening. In a moment, we're going to another 5 minute break. By all means, join one of the breakout rooms. Immediately after the break, we'll be welcomed straight back by Jocelyn Coates, and then I will see you again after that. Enjoy your break.
Sa sorto d'uomo di fuochi pari.
Oh, that was amazing. Welcome back, everybody, to the third and final part of this evening's concert. Justin, you are an amazing performer. My goodness, people watching at home, perhaps you don't know that Justin graduated from King's College London in 2014. She's a composer as well as a performer. She's been to the Trinity. She's also been to City. She gained a distinction in her master's in music. My goodness, she's got quite a talent. It is so great to have you performing for us, Jocelyn. And what a great show we've had so far. I've just heard some super news. I'm sharing it with you all now. I've just heard that £1,400 has been raised from your generosity this evening. Many thanks, everybody. Keep on coming if you possibly can. If you haven't had a chance to donate yet, please do. Let me introduce our next act. Oh, let me tell you a joke first. I've just heard it. You might have seen it on the screen. What is orange, orange and sounds like a parrot? What is orange and sounds like a parrot? A carrot.
I know.
Thank you, Alison Keresey. That is a very good one. Everybody, we've got three or four more acts for you, and we've got some absolute treats coming up. The next performer is somebody who comes to Emmanuel Church, but is also an organist and director of music at Church St. Oswald's up in Norbury. We are very lucky to have such a talented guest this evening, and Anne Hubble is going to play the Allegro by Joseph Hector Fiocco. Thank you, Anne.
Anne and I would like to play for you Fiocco's Allegro. Thank you.
Amazing, amazing. Thank you, Anne. You played so beautifully for us. And how amazing that you're able to speak to yourself at the beginning. I've seen several of these people now who Joey we saw was in four places at once. Jocelyn seemed to be in five places at once. And you were in two places at once. There's only one of me, you'll be pleased to hear. There's only one Charlie Fillingham speaking to you live from Fillingham Towers. What a great, great show so far. The Sinclairs, I'm not reading that joke out. That's just too awful. Forsdyke, I'm not doing that one either. I think you've had that one. And the Keresey's, I think you're better on the orange, to be honest. The policeman joke is not as good. But do keep those jokes coming. We've got just time for one or two more after this. after, I've just seen the chat bar come up. Thank you, darling. After this next performer. Now, the next piece we're going to hear, we've just heard one director of music and organist from St. Oswald's Church. How amazing to be able to welcome our own organist, Richard Mash from Emmanuel Church. He's chosen to play the Dambusters March for us. Feel free, please, to put your goggles on if you wish to join the RAF during this. You may also fly around the room if you wish and drop your bombs on the reservoirs in the Ruhrgebiet in Germany. I give you permission to do that right now. Thank you so much, Richard. Take it away, the Dambusters.
Thank you.
Brilliant. Chocks away, everybody. It's the Dan Busters. Thank you so much. That was really super, Richard. Really super. Final joke. Final joke, everybody. And thank you to Tim for raising the level of the joke slightly. He says, I am, therefore I think. Or is that putting Descartes before the horse? I think that's very good. I think that's very good indeed. Listen, everybody, we've got two more things left. I am so pleased to be able to welcome Five Vocal, who've sung for us before. There's five of them, and they're singing, and they're absolutely first class. They're going to sing an Elvis Presley number, I Can't Help Falling in Love with You. I'm fortunate enough in the same room here to have my lovely wife with me. Darling, I can't help falling in love with you. She refused to join me to co-present this evening, but I think she's regretting it now because it could have been such a wonderful thing. I love you, darling. I can't help falling in love with you. No response, everybody. Absolutely no response at all. Stony silence. Listen, it has been such a great concert. If you haven't donated yet, please still do that. There are two more things, exciting things to come. We're going to hear Five Vocal. After that, we're once again cutting live to the Smith residence for fireworks, absolutely live. We heard Sheridan live, we're going to see fireworks live. Thank you, Lincoln, for sorting that out for us, live in the back garden. And when we've seen and enjoyed the fireworks, we will open again the breakout rooms. If you want to join a breakout room and chat and just enjoy spending some time together, isn't it great to spend time together, even though we are so far apart? I've been Charlie Fillingham. It has been a delight to welcome you and look after you this evening. Over to Five Vocal. Goodbye.
Wise men say only fools rush him, but I can't help falling in love with you.
Darling, so it goes.